to that intro.
I thought we'd try out the Stone Temple Pilots for a change.
Right on. That's Todd, everybody. I'm Mark. And you've found the Rational Revolution. So glad you're here. And I'm so glad that this guy's freaking here. I have been trying to get him on the show since I took over from our dear beloved Chris Alfheim. This dude's one of the busiest men in politics. And I'm so honored that he's here. You all know him. A little known fact, we do share a birthday month. All good people were born in December of 1986. This is all around good guy, Lieutenant Governor Mandela Barnes. Dude, oh my God, in the flesh.
My man, this schedule has been just so hectic. It's been wild. I've been traveling in and out of state. Got myself more busy than I could have imagined myself being, but it's all good. It's a lot of work to be done.
Now that's awesome, I'm honored and so appreciative that you took time out of your busy schedule, because I know how freaking busy it is trying to get you here. Take some time for little old us and thank you. Like, genuinely, thank you.
I know, for sure, man. Thank you for having me, man.
Thank you. So I want to give, kind of start off, you know, you served in the assembly, and I think you were you in the Senate as well? You ran for Senate.
Yep.
And then you ran for Lieutenant Governor. I really want to give our listeners like a behind the scenes of like, what is it like being the Lieutenant Governor of the state of Wisconsin?
Senates don't want me.
We'll talk about that, which that's crap, by the way. But
yeah, man, I can tell you. So the experience of Lieutenant Governor, like, most amazing experience of my life for so many reasons, right? Getting to travel and experience all that Wisconsin has to offer, getting to meet so many just incredible people, and being able to learn, honestly, that's probably my biggest takeaway. It was a huge learning experience. And the fact that there were so many people willing to teach, so many people willing to share, whether it's my visits to different reservations, whether it's my visits to family farms, or visits to small businesses, all these things like provided something new to me that I had never had a chance to be a part of before. You know, one of the things that stuck out of my first time going to a slaughterhouse, which was wild.
Oh.
Yeah, I know.
You saw everything?
Oh, I saw it, man. I saw it.
Does it make you appreciate a salad a little bit more?
Well, it happened so quick. And the guy wasn't like, hey, it's getting ready to happen. It just happened, right? Like,
oh, my God.
You know, it's just the pride, like, you get tased, the cow falls to the ground, it up, off with his head, right? Like, it's just,
oh my God, and that's crazy.
It was wild, right? But it's a thing that I'll never forget, and it just speaks to so many complexities, right? Like,
the
folks to step up and do to provide for families across the state and across the country. It also speaks to some of our supply chain issues and having adequate staff, and if we want to keep things, you know, local, we need to make sure we're investing in a small family farm. But yeah, being Lieutenant Governor, though, I will say it just depends on your relationship with the governor. And I know people in other states who don't necessarily have a great relationship with their governor, and it has made that experience a little more difficult, a little bit challenging. Even here in Wisconsin, we've had situations where the Lieutenant Governor and the governor didn't have a rosy relationship. There, you know, stories would come out all the time about how the administration before ours was sort of keep the Lieutenant Governor at bay sometimes. And
there's a bookcase in front of that stairwell.
Like, so two administrations. Yeah. This is not any partisan thing, because the administration before that one, there was that issue. There was no bookcase separating my office and the governor.
No.
The record.
Yeah. Now, so how was that? Was it... talk about that.
Yeah, I mean, I got nothing but respect for Tony, love and admiration. Fortunately, you know, had known him prior to him running for governor. When he was superintendent, I was on the education committee, so we had some familiarity.
Oh, yeah.
And then there was just a respect for each other. And I think that when we both ended up on the ticket together, you know, the first thing we did was acknowledge how different we were as individuals.
That was a cool campaign. That was really cool.
Man, it was like, if it was cool to witness, I can't even explain how cool it was to be a part of.
Really?
And like, leaning into those differences, right? Like, that was the cool part for me. Like, I, you know, I wasn't expecting him to be like me or to change. And you know, the opposite is also true. And we legit, you know, enjoyed each other's company. And, you know, I still hit him up every now and then. He still takes my calls. I don't abuse that, right? Like, if it's someone I give him a call and, you know, it just works out that way. So, yeah, having that good relationship made my experience as Lieutenant Governor so memorable.
Yeah, it does. And for the listeners, you know, I hope you remember, you know, some of the, I mean, just the relationship that you guys had on the campaign trail and joking around. And it seemed like you genuinely enjoyed each other's company and had a lot of respect for each other's ideas and could make each other better.
You can't script that. You can't fake that. It'll show up.
So what, and I, this is out of genuine curiosity. They have a governor's mansion. Is there like a lieutenant governor's apartment or only, something? Or like, you know,
Pennsylvania, I believe, is the only state with a lieutenant governor's residence.
No kidding. Really?
Yeah. I think Pennsylvania might be the only state.
What the hell? We got to work on that.
Got to work on that.
Yeah. We got to work. And so like, were you in like the cabinet meetings? I know you toured all the state.
Was
impact on policy.
Was in the cabinet meetings. And the other part too is, you know, when we were going through the transition, once, you know, we won office and prior to us being sworn in, you know, he asked, what was I interested in? What did I want to do? What issues did I want to take on? I told him,
That's cool.
Climate change, right? And that doesn't always happen. A lot of times,
that's cool.
The issues, they're just delegated. They'll say, hey, you know, you need to do this, you need to do that. And that's just what it is. And I told him what I wanted to do. And so, got to be a part of those cabinet meetings. Also got to, you know, lead our climate change task force. And I got to also work with all of our state agencies, well, for the most part, a lot of our state agencies on the topic of sustainability, right? It was more than just a task force. It was working with state agencies. It was being a part of some of the things they had going on. I would invite them out to some of our events. They would invite me out to some of their events. And it was just going across the state, just talking about, you know, opportunity, how folks in the state of Wisconsin can thrive and how the state government may had not played a real role in folks' progress before, but this was our opportunity to do so.
Yeah, we're talking with former Lieutenant Governor Mandela Barnes. How was the transition? You know, that was you smile.
I'm calling for good reasons, right? Like it was, of course, hectic, right? There were so many people involved. There are people who've been waiting 8 years to get their issues heard.
Yeah.
During the transition period, we had our transition office and it was just a constant flow of people in and out, talking about whatever issue and how the state needed to prioritize that issue. And, you know, this, for the most part, they were all righteous issues. And I'll say as well, you know, like there were also a bunch of people who were like, hey, you know, need a job. And we had to hire anyway, right? We had to hire people. But then, you know, sometimes you get folks who are just like, hey, can you get my husband a job? It's just like, come on now. That's not how this works. Like he didn't even say, hey, my husband's interested in highways. I think he created the Department of Transportation. It's just like, hey, my husband needs a job. not how things were. I had a legislator that the first thing before she even congratulated me, she said, hey, can you get my husband a job?
Shut up, really?
That's not how that works.
Oh my God.
I didn't really hear from her much afterwards.
It's weird.
Didn't have a magic wand. Employ your partner,
right? Yeah, that's unfortunate. You know, and I think you know, it's interesting. It's kind of like when you got into office, and you know, it's almost like George W. Bush and 9/11, how that event changed everything. So you get in what, 2019, elected as the first Black lieutenant governor in state history. And you're like, oh my God, all right, now we can get into, oh crap, here's a pandemic. You know? And it changes the world.
Changes everything, man. Truly feel like, you know, got robbed of a year.
Yes.
Stuff, right? Like I wasn't traveling the state at that point, wasn't getting around to as many places as I otherwise would have gotten to, wasn't being able to participate in the events, speaking at the graduations, doing the school.
Yeah.
Doing the tours to different communities, right? Like all that sort of stopped. I mean, everything went virtual. And I do feel like my time in office was truncated because of the pandemic.
I bet, yeah.
But, you know, at the same time, leaders are, you know, determined, in my opinion, on what sort of tests they face. And that was like an ultimate test of leadership. Yeah. And granted, you know, the things and the fact that we were able to recover so quickly from the pandemic, that falls on the governor, his leadership, and being able to navigate impossible times. But yeah, you know, I mean, I was out there a whole lot, you know, doing the things that would keep people in the state of Wisconsin safe, and also being a part of, you know, those strategy meetings. And that's why I say it was a learning experience, if nothing else. I got to learn how everything functions. And I do believe the governor saw me as a part of the governing team. Otherwise, I wouldn't have been in those meetings. Otherwise, I wouldn't have participated at the level I did, or even be able to build the relationships with cabinet secretaries that I had.
Yeah. I would, you know, can you imagine if we had someone else in there, you know, your opponents from that election? Oh my God.
Elections have consequences.
Yeah.
And, you know, there's real life that happens when people are in office, and there are decisions that get made that, you know, you can go in the direction of prioritizing people's safety, or, you know, you can just disregard people's livelihoods, which could have been the case.
Yeah, that's wild. And, you know, it's, I think, yeah, like you say, it really is a testament to the leadership that we had during that time, that we were able to kind of get through that. As I mean, it sucked anywhere. Three ways to Sunday, but like, you
it was
know,
not fun. It was not
oh
fun.
Oh my God. I can't, and I want to ask you about this on the other side, because, you know, there's so much to this, and I want to get back to this on the other side of the break here. We're talking with Mandela Barnes here, former Lieutenant Governor. I'm Mark Becker. We'll see you in a little bit. What's up, everybody? We're back here on the Rational Revolution. Mark Becker talking with former Lieutenant Governor and dear friend Mandela Barnes. We're talking about the wonderful time that we all had during COVID. And when did you, like, so obviously, you know, you're the second most powerful person in the state of Wisconsin. When did you guys, like, first your ears perk up about, like, oh, that's kind of messed up about COVID-19. And then what was the moment when you're like, oh crap, we have to do something immediately?
Yes. Right. So you remember late February, you were hearing about stuff.
Yeah.
Late February, when it seemed like it was on the horizon, but nobody's paying that much attention. I remember the first weekend in March, I was in New Orleans.
Okay.
And like, that's when it all came down, right? Yeah. Like, after that first weekend, I'm like, oh, boy, first of all, I'm glad I got to go. But, you know, it's just like by St. Patrick's Day, it was like, you know, that tough conversation where it's just like, okay, well, you know, the other states around us are, you know, starting to make hard choices. And I don't know how we sit and ignore this. You know, we have to start taking precautions.
Yeah. And then, you know, that was just really an incredible period of time. And then you have COVID. And then in the middle of this pandemic, we have the summer of 2020. And let me tell you, so, and I talk about this a lot, you know, I'm a white man grown up in a very white suburb of Green Bay. And it really, and it's, I'm embarrassed to say this, but I only say this because I hope it helps people understand. I really, really got my eyes started to be open. I married a black woman. And so, you know, I knew that there was inequality, but then, you know, we just celebrated our eighth anniversary. And so it's really, it's like you see these things happen and you're like, oh my God, like that's messed up. That's messed. And then, you know, we go through this great awakening as a society, if you will. And that hits home in Wisconsin. How was that as the first black lieutenant governor in the state facing this huge, huge wave of, I don't even know what to call it.
Well, a lot of people were having new conversations and there's a certain responsibility that falls.
Yes.
And like, it again, if it already was not easy dealing with the pandemic, having this on top of everything.
Oh my God.
Made it just like, yeah. Dude, I could write a book on all this. Probably should write a book on all this.
You should.
Because there was already frustration, consternation because of, you know, people being on lockdown, lives being just changed in a completely, you know, the idea of work shifting, all this stuff, right?
And different communities were affected more about the lockdown than others. You know, like
communities were affected, people's economic conditions, you know, got worse in a lot of areas. Yeah. And then you had all this frustration on top of, you know, the issues around racial justice after killing George Floyd. And, you know, communities were stuck with, you know, all right, well, what is the proper response? And the thing about answering the question about a proper response is the George Floyd, you know, that killing, it happened.
Oh God.
But like topics, the issues that people were bringing up were nowhere near new. Mm-hmm. And so dealing with just generations of, whether it's trauma or dealing with generations of, you know, anguish, frustration at, you know, a system that folks feel as, you know, if it had not been there to protect them, that just led to just a certain anger that was just directed at everybody, right? Like everybody, regardless of, you know, if you were trying to do the right thing or you weren't trying to do the right thing. So it became not just difficult to navigate with folks who were completely dismissive of the issue of racial injustice, and the same people who are trying to determine what books you can read, the same people who are trying to determine what you can learn in the school, the same people who are trying to deny Kamala Harris of her blackness. You know, it's like, even, you know, aside from those folks, like the people, you know, who were out protesting, the people who were out demanding justice, it to them, it felt like a complete, you know, system failure. So it didn't matter. It was so far beyond partisan politics.
And, yeah.
You know, to try to get out there and reason. Like, I know people who were out there, like I know elected officials who were out there protesting every day, right alongside
that's cool.
people. And but they still, even them, they still were, you know, were criticized by somebody about things not happening to the degree that folks feel like things should have been happening. And it's because of the issues that get swept under the rug so often, you know, over the course of time, it builds up.
Yeah.
There's going to be a big old lump in that rug, and you think you're just going to be walking to the living room. You're going to trip over it one day, and not only are you going to trip over, you're going to be carrying a hot pot of coffee, and then it's going to be spilled everywhere and on yourself, and now everything is messed up.
You know, and I think you articulate this stuff so well, and I didn't think I was going to go down this road, but so like, what, where are we post summer of 2020? Like, are things better?
Oh, in many ways I think we've regressed.
Okay. Right, you know, right. It kind of feels that way.
It does.
Why
feel did many
that
ways.
How? I don't get it.
So, well, a lot of the response was performative.
Yeah.
You know, it wasn't necessarily substantive.
Yeah.
Right? Like, so much was done for you know, appeasement now. Like, you have an issue like criminal justice reform that barely even gets talked about. And the thing about it, when I was in the assembly, you know, Grover Norquist, who's certainly no fan of mine, no liberal by any means, he was on his, you know, Right on Crime tour talking about criminal justice reform, trying to get Republican lawmakers in states to understand why the traditional way of, you know, of criminal justice just was, you know, out of date, why it was no longer effective and also a drain on resources for states. And there were a lot of states where Republican lawmakers were on board, championed reforms, introduced reforms. And, you know, you can even look at the I can't even think of the bill right now. Something that even Ron Johnson voted for. What was the name of this? I can't think of this. I can't think of the bill right now. It was obviously top of my mind during the campaign. But like, there are these pieces of legislation that passed at the state level, or a piece of legislation that passed even at the federal level, and now folks are just backing away from it. And the thing is, like, this is something you have to be in for the long term, right? Like, we are, like, this is system-wide change we're talking about. And you can't, you also can't implement criminal justice reform without investing in communities as well to make sure that young people who may have been on a path to the criminal justice system have a diversion, have a have a clear path to education, have a clear path to a career. And I think that is the, I think that's the biggest piece of it that was never really cemented. And if that's not the case, it could seem like criminal justice reform was a failure because of it.
Yeah. We're talking with former Lieutenant Governor Mandela Barnes. We're going to continue this discussion right after the break. We're going to talk about where's Wisconsin here with all of this fun stuff leading up to November. See you in a little bit. Welcome back to the Rational Revolution. We got a hell of a guest here, my friend and yours, former Lieutenant Governor Mandela Barnes. We're talking about, you know, kind of where we are post George Floyd, and not George Floyd, but I mean it was the Great Awakening, kind of, if you will. But you're talking about how a lot of the outrage, and it was all like a fad. You know, people made protesting a fad, and nothing really substantial came from it. And that's sad to say, but I think it's kind of true, you know?
Yeah, and I do want to clarify, like, I'm not talking about the folks who were, you know, out there and
right,
you know,
yeah.
Like, so I, but I am
there's
saying,
a lot
like,
of people that did a lot of good stuff.
A whole lot. But, yeah. You know, there's a lot of pop activism.
Yes. Yes.
That takes place.
Yeah, no, that's totally true. And one of the unfortunate things that I think came out of that is, you know, when you ran against America's worst senator, Ron Johnson, and he made that entire campaign color and race and fear. And, you know, sans the opinion of, what, 26,000 people, we would have made him stick to his promise of being a two-term senator. Unfortunately, that didn't happen. But I do think that, you know, the worst of people, you know, in terms of the underlying racism, all that kind of stuff, that's exactly what happened, in my opinion.
Yeah, I mean, there's layers. I mean, there is.
You know, yeah.
I'll let people make that argument, and I can, you know, specifically, but I can specifically point to the flood of money, right? This is the largest independent expenditure. This is the largest amount of dark money spending in the Senate race. Was outspent by $26 million.
No kidding, really.
In third party spending, $26 million came out to 26,000 votes. You know, so that is a big piece of it as well. And you know, on the other hand, you know, the governor, the outside spending for the governor, he was about $25 million up on his opponent. And this is the third party spending, so this is not irrespective of candidates in candidacy. And so that 26, 25, the $51 million gap between, you know, funding my third party, the third party operation that supported me versus the governor. And we came out to about 51,000 votes separation between myself. And the numbers line up almost too perfectly. And the thing is, you know, candidate for candidate, I ended up raising a little bit more money than in this Senator Johnson, but is the third party. It was the other part about it too is like we're talking about a handful of people. We're talking about Beeline, and just like a handful of people who put a whole lot of money that wasn't really a dent in their pockets, because it's all, you know, resources, benefits that they reap because of the Trump tax law that Senator Johnson voted for.
Yeah.
Right. So that was pocket change, right? That was a little bit of the cost savings that they were able to enjoy.
Yeah. And it's unfortunate. And I think about this a lot when I see Ron Johnson continuing to peddle the, you know, election denialism and tinfoil hat stuff. And it's like, oh my God. Well, you know, you said at the beginning, me and Senator just don't get along. It's like, I hope that we haven't heard the last from you. And I know you're doing something now. Talk about that you've, I mean, why you're so freaking busy.
Yeah, man. You know, as I tell everybody, there are a lot of folks who put a whole lot into me, put a lot into my campaign.
You're worth it, dude. You're a good dude. You're well, absolutely worth it. That money's well spent. And I mean, time and everything. You. Yeah.
I sincerely appreciate that. Not even fishing for compliments. I'm saying, but you know, like so many people showed up for me in just incredible ways, and for me to just walk away because we didn't win would feel sort of selfish.
Yeah.
You know, I know people who don't win and they end up moving, like leaving the state completely.
Yeah.
It's like, all right, well, if that was what this was about, then why were we even in the race?
Yeah.
But Milwaukee is home. Wisconsin is home. I made a commitment, like even getting into the race, that I would do everything I could to try to make this place better for everybody. And that commitment stands. And I said, whether I was going to run for office, whether I'm in office or not, the work still has to get done. And so since I've been out, I've been up to a couple things. One is Power to the Polls, Wisconsin, and we're focused on civic engagement, focused on infrequent voters. We actually were very active in Green Bay. Our organization helped flip the Green Bay City Council, and you know,
that's awesome. Oh my God!
If you need that statement validated, you can ask the mayor on that one.
No, I know he's a friend. He's the old God, yeah.
He will tell you as much. You know, Power to the Polls was the only outside spender
That's awesome.
Yeah, and I say too, you know, I look at what voter turnout could have been, and like I got a lot of reasons to be frustrated and upset, but you know, I can channel that frustration into productivity. And so standing up a large scale organization that is going to focus its efforts on driving voter turnout, going back to my roots as a community organizer, is something that means a lot to me, something I want to be involved in. Another group I started actually is called Forward Together Wisconsin. And Forward Together Wisconsin is focused on primarily focused on implementation of the Inflation Reduction Act.
Nice.
So many syllables, man, so many syllables. But the IRA is the single biggest piece of legislation to reduce emissions and combat climate change in the history of the world. Unfortunately, a lot of folks don't know about it or how to take advantage of those resources. So forwardtogetherwi.org, you can find out how you as an individual can save money, as a business, as a nonprofit. And I've been able to marry my passions, right? Like, climate change, as I mentioned at the top of the show, was a big deal for me, still is a big deal for me. Equity and sustainability. So starting this organization gives me an opportunity to continue that work. Another project also I'm involved in is called the Democracy Defense Project. And that is it's in a number of battleground states across the country. But here in Wisconsin, it is a bipartisan effort. There are four of us, two Democrats, two Republicans. And we are talking about election integrity. We just did a With Politics panel 2 days ago.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So a couple of Republicans, former Congressman Scott Klug, former Attorney General J.B. Van Hollen. You know, and I was in the state legislature when Van Hollen was AG.
Yeah.
Yep. Always nice enough dude. We, you know, just didn't agree on things. But now we're here and we're talking about the cause of democracy and how to instill faith in safe and secure elections that take place in Wisconsin, and lifting up our poll workers.
That's cool. And I know it's funny. My brother lives in D.C. and I'm gonna embarrass the ever loving hell out of it. You know the story because I messaged it to you. But he was uh, he just messaged me like in the morning, frantic in all caps. He's like, "Oh my god, I almost just ran over Hot Mandela Barnes," and and so, and that's what he refers you as. And so, so you were in DC working on stuff, and you've been in New York, and I mean, you're everywhere, dude.
Yeah, I mean, you know, still doing speaking engagements, right? Like, I, you know, since the time I spoke at a number of state Democratic Party dinners, headed to Memphis in a couple weeks to speak there, you know, one of their party dinners. And for the DNC, I'm going to be going to a number of state delegation breakfasts.
Oh, nice.
Giving speeches there. So,
what? So, I want to ask, because you know, number one, where are we as a country? Should we be nervous? Should we be hopeful? There's the yes.
If the last 8 years have taught us anything, is to, I guess, always be not necessarily nervous, but aware. I really can't answer the question. We're going to find out where we are
right.
in the country in just less than 3 months.
We got a hell of a checkup coming up, man. You know?
I am optimistic, right? Like, I've been optimistic before, though, and have been let down. You know, at this point in 2020, if you asked me, I would have said that, you know, Biden would beat Trump by at least 5 points. Mm-hmm. As we know, it was a 1-point race. Mm-hmm. So less than a point. And I do feel optimistic. I feel good about things. I feel like we have a real shot here, but I don't want to get too optimistic, right? Like, I just want to make sure we're doing the work. I want to encourage others to do so and get involved as if we're down by a point.
Yeah. And so, you know, I'm thrilled that Kamala Harris is at the top of the ticket. I think she's absolutely incredible, and I can't wait to see her fillet Donald Trump on national television.
Yeah.
But that's going to be sweet. But, you know, we got Tammy Baldwin. She was on the show in studio, you know, and she's it looks like up, you know, a good amount on against perennial candidate for office and California resident Eric Hovde. So that's good. And she mentioned the new maps, how that's going to be a game changer for Governor Evers.
New maps for the whole state. Certainly for a whole state. We have candidates in 97 districts this cycle. So, you know, the energy that down ballot tickets or down ballot races can generate shouldn't be understated. We got candidates who are out there running grassroots campaigns, knocking on doors. People are showing up to community events, showing up to meat raffles, showing up to whatever the event may be. I think it does the whole cause some good, because it is a presence of a candidate who is a Democrat when that may not have otherwise been the case. And I guess I forgot to mention my own PAC, because that's the first thing that I did. So I did start a political action committee. It's called The Long Run. And I guess I didn't mention
that. Talk about that. Yes.
Yeah. So the PAC, not my job. I don't take a single dime from the PAC. I do not get paid by the PAC. At all. We raise money and invest those resources in candidates across the country. Certainly Tammy Baldwin, you know, we've done a lot to support her. And now that these primaries are done, we look to support our congressional candidates as well. And the goal is to support those candidates, typically who are labeled different, right? Like, there was a commercial from one of the third party groups that said, it just ended by saying Mandela Barnes, different, you know, and we all obviously knew what that was about. And during the debate, the first debate, you know, the moderator gave us a chance to clarify anything. And I said, well, you know, I want to talk about, you know, the commercial that ended by saying Mandela Barnes, different, but I don't want to push back on it. I want to embrace it. I think the problem is too much of our politics are the same.
Yeah.
The homogeny of, how homogenous the U.S. Senate is the reason things don't get done for working people. The fact that we have basically a singular perspective in the United States Senate is why progress has been impeded. And I think we need more people who are different if we want things to change. And, you know, I do feel that candidates that get labeled different have a chance, and people in general who are labeled different have a chance to go on to make the biggest difference, and we want to be able to support them.
That's awesome. And I know we have we're running up on the clock here, but I do have one question. I'd be remiss if I wouldn't ask, what's next for you? Are you going to run for something?
I'm gonna tell you, like, honestly, like, if the moment calls for it, yes. I am more yes and no. I'm certainly open to running, but like, do I have my sights set on something in particular? I, at this moment, I don't. I can honestly say, 2023 was a great year for me on so many levels.
I'm happy
this
for you.
This year has been great too. It's just hard to compare it to last year. And I'm getting to do the things that I care about, right? Like, it's not like I'm completely out. It's not like I'm not still engaging at a certain level, although, you know, it's not being in office, but I don't think you have to be in office to do the work.
Yeah. You can breathe a little bit, you know, and be, you know, a little more free of what you want and choose what you want to do.
Yeah.
You know, I do hope that some sort of an election does cross your path again, because I think you're just an incredibly genuine person. And you have a heart of service, and I thank you again for being who you are, being my friend, and everything that you've done for this community and the state. Thank you for your time, brother.
I appreciate you, man. Thanks for
having me. Appreciate it, buddy. You too. Thank you so much. Russian Revolution. We talked to Lieutenant Governor Mandela Barnes. Thanks. Thanks for sticking around here on the Rational Revolution. You know, so I'm kind of like, I look at what I do here on the radio. I'm still a rookie. And so, you know, Todd the God here, who's kind of my coach and everything, like, I try to do my best, and I work on, like, the intros and the outros, and sometimes it's like, you got the Rational, you know, it's just a jumbled mess of, you know, word salad. And so, you know, I appreciate everyone giving me the time to grow into this and all of that. But I am, it's such a fun thing to do. It really is a blast. And, you know, selfishly, because I get to talk to incredible people, you know, like Tammy Baldwin and Mandela Barnes and, you know, and whoever we're going to have coming up. It's going to be wonderful. Ben Wickler, everybody. This is so cool. And it's such an honor to bring all of this to all of you. And so thank you for all of that, as I see my son waving in the window there. And speaking of Mandela Barnes, what an incredible person, you know. And I hope that, you know, I got to know him during the campaign pretty well. And I have such an infinite amount of respect for him. He's someone... You know, I always say that if my phone would get stolen, I'd have a huge problem because of all the contacts I have in there. But Mandela is one, he's always picked up my phone call. He has always texted me back. He's such, and I'm a nobody, and he's the lieutenant governor. He's such an incredibly wonderful person. And I really hope that his life of service is not over, because... You know, we were so well served by someone that is such a deep thinker and kind-hearted person as him. But I kind of want to pivot a little bit to a conversation that I had with my wife. And I want to talk about a couple different things, you know, explicitly the rise of extremism. And Lieutenant Governor Barnes hit on this a little bit when we were talking about where are we? You know, did we really grow as a society? And he said, meh, you know, and that scares me because, you know, I talked about being this basic white guy without a ton of experience that Mandela has had, or that my wife, who is a black woman, has had. And she said that, you know, growing up, if she would go into a place or if she was somewhere where, you know, as a person of color, you know, you don't go, there's some hesitation. There's, you know, you just shut up and you leave, you know, which is a sad thing to say in today's society. But she said what's so different about society now is with the rise of extremism brought to you by your friends in the Donald Trump campaign, with that rise of extremism and hatred, people are emboldened and they have the courage to now say the thing. And, you know, whether it is someone who is a person of color, whether they are a member of the LGBT community, you know, as we were driving to the polls, and you know, there's a guy here, Elijah Behnke, that has on his signs conservative family values. We know with that, say the thing. You don't like gay people, you know? And they have the courage, and it's, if you call it that, it's not courage, but they're emboldened to spread that hatred. And you know, you have this thing in the back of your head where, well, do I go into this place because someone's going to say something, someone's going to do something, you know? And that rise of angst has led her to potentially look at, well, she started filling out passport applications for our children and ourselves. And so it's like, but that's a real thing. That's a scary thing. And, you know, how do we move past this? How do we get through this? And it's you, for as emboldened as they are to spread hatred, and for as emboldened as they are to spread bigotry, we have to be emboldened to push back on that every chance that we get. So it's not so much to say, oh, well, we just shut up and go away. No, I think you and I have the responsibility to stand up and say, okay, well, this isn't right. And for people that are in the middle, purple, you know, former Republicans like myself, we have a responsibility to call out, this is the second thing I want to talk about, the hypocrisy in the GOP. And, you know, it's something, I saw a video of Nikki Haley talking about how I hope Donald Trump wins, but he's not going to win, talking about, you know, crowd sizes and all these things. It's like, but then this is the woman who said she wasn't going to vote for the guy because she doesn't think he could stand up to Putin and he's unstable and all of these things. And so here she is going on national television saying that she hopes he wins. And so it is up to us to be able to stick your feet in the sand and dig in your heels and say, wait a minute. And not to do it in a way that's disrespectful, and not to do it in a way that divides, because that won't do anything. And as we talked about with Mandela Barnes, you know, about where this country is going, and my wife, you know, seeing that this could be an unrecognizable place, so filling out passports, do I think it will come to that? Well, no, but everybody thinks it won't come to that until it happens. And it is happening, and we have to be aware of this, because this extremism, this will not go away. You know, Donald Trump doesn't lose. He doesn't. He blames someone else. He blames something else. And then that happens. You know, he talked about how Joe Biden was unconstitutionally removed from the ticket. And you know, we talked about how I believe it was a George Washington-esque moment of selflessness. I mean, we have to look at these lies, these things that are making our communities divided, and we have to stand up to them. That is the issue. And so if there's anything that comes from this show, even if it's me being selfish and talking to really cool people and being able to bring it to you, if you get something out of this, I want you to have the courage of your own convictions. And as this song plays, I get all emotional as I love my friend Kristen. Have that courage to say the thing, to stand up for what is right, because that is all we have between us and the devil, as they say. Love y'all. Thanks for sticking around. Mark Becker on the Rational Revolution. And wrote a song.